Undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love to me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee.
Oh, pray for somebody right here, Charlotte.
To make you proud, I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean.
I know what you've spoken.
Good morning, Wheaton Christian Center. If y'all excited to be in the room this morning, can you just wave at me? Come on, wave at me, wave at me, wave at me, wave at me. Do me a favor, can you shake the person next to you? Just wake them up. I know it's morning, but can we go forth and worship? God, we speak of a spirit of freedom and liberty in the room. We pray, God, that you will meet us here this morning and that you will have your way, God. We're going to sing about the great name of Jesus. Come on, let's go forth. Hey, come on. Come on, clap your hands. Come on. Come on, y'all know this one. Yeah.
Said, we love to call your name. It's something we cannot explain. That happens when we proclaim your great name. Your great name. Sing, say. We love to call your name.
Call your name.
Cannot say.
We cannot explain.
That happens.
That happens
when we
proclaim your great name.
Your great name.
Your great name.
Sing it, say, King, say.
King Jesus.
No other.
No other name. King Jesus.
Nobody stronger.
None stronger.
We can call on. Everything changes.
Yeah. When we call on.
Come on. Everybody clap your hands in the room. Come on. Come on, sing. Say, we love.
We love to
call on your.
Call your name. It's something
we cannot say.
We cannot explain.
That happens.
That happens.
When we
when we proclaim your great name.
Your great name.
Your
come on, move. Sing it, say, King, say.
King Jesus.
No other.
No other. Yeah.
Yeah, nobody's stronger.
No stronger. We can call.
Yeah, everything changes.
It changes, but yeah. We call.
Come on, tell
me.
Sing it again, sing it again. Say, King, say.
King Jesus.
No other.
No other name. King Jesus.
Yeah, nobody's stronger.
No stronger.
We can call. On. Everything changes.
It changes. Yeah.
Come on, let's sing this. There is power in the name of Jesus. Come on, sing. Power. Power in your name. Let me hear you say, yeah. Say. Yeah. Of Jesus. So much power in your name. Yeah. There is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power in.
Power in your name.
Yeah. There is power in.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power in.
Power in your name.
Things change when we call. Say.
Things change when we call you,
yeah.
Jesus.
Things change when.
Things change when we call your name.
Yeah. Things change when.
Things change when we, yeah, call you, Jesus.
Things change when.
Things change when we call.
Come on, sing. Come on. Said I'm free when.
I'm free when I call your name.
Yeah, I'm free when
I call you, Jesus.
I'm free when
I call your name.
Come on, sing. Say when I call your name. Say
when I call your name.
When I call your name.
When I call your name.
Demons tremble when we call. Say
when I call your name.
Yeah. When I call your name.
When I call
come
your
on,
name.
I'm free when I'm free when
I call your name.
I'm set free
when I call your name.
Said I'm alive when I call. Say
when I call your
come on.
Name.
Say when I call your name.
When I call your name.
I feel my breakthrough when I call. Say
when I call your name.
I feel my healing when I call you.
When I call your name.
I feel my breakthrough when I call.
When I call your name.
I feel my breakthrough. Come on, can we just jump in the room? Come on. Everybody jump in the room. Come on. Yeah, there was freedom in your presence, Jesus. Come on. Yeah, there's freedom in your presence. There's freedom in your presence. Yeah, there is freedom in your presence. There was freedom in your presence, yeah.
Yeah, I feel the breakthrough when I call.
When I call your name.
I feel your glory when I call.
When I call your name.
I feel my presence when I call.
When I call your name.
Say when I call your last time.
When I call your name.
Come on, make some noise, yeah. God, you are the lion and the lamb. And nothing can stand against you. Come on, give me like this. Come on. Come on, see y'all clap it. Come on. Hey, yeah. 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 Hey. He's coming on a cloud. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. So who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's warring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is a lamb, the lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the lion and the lamb. Said every knee will bow before. Come on, clap, come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So open up the gate, make way before the King of Kings. Yeah. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. So who can stop the Lord Almighty? Come on, say it to you, come on.
Our God is a lion.
Glory with power.
He's roaring with power.
And he's fighting our battles.
And fighting our battles.
And every knee will bow.
Every knee will bow.
Yeah, our God is the Lamb.
Our God is the Lamb. The Lamb that was slain
for
the sins of the world.
His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before
the lion.
Every knee will bow. Come on, sing this with me, come on. So who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Let me hear you say it, come on. Yeah, who can stop the Lord all together sing, yeah.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No, no one can, no,
who can stop the Lord Almighty?
I said, no, no one can, no, yeah.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Yeah, who can stop the Lord, yeah.
Who can stop the Lord?
Come on, everybody clap your hands like this, come on, come on. Here we go, sing. Our God is saying,
our God is the lion,
the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power
and fighting
our battle.
Every name
will bow before.
Our God is the Lamb.
The Lamb that was slain.
The Lamb that was
for the sins of the world.
For the sins of the world.
His blood breaks the chains.
His blood breaks the chains.
Every knee will bow.
Every knee will bow before the lion.
Every knee will bow.
Every knee will bow before.
Clap your hands in the room. Oh, yeah. Come on. Clap them hands real loud. Come on. Last time. Yeah. Yeah, come on, make some noise. Oh. I don't know about you guys, but I came to receive a refreshing from the Holy Spirit. I came to receive his fire, his power. So can you do me a favor real quick? Just lift your hands all over the room. God, let this be a sign of surrenderance. See, Senor, yes. A sign of surrenderance, a sign of praise, a sign of desperation for you, Jesus. And God, what we ask for you this morning is that your Holy Spirit would come in this room. And that we would even see what we saw in the Bible in Acts and how the Holy Spirit came in the room like a mighty rushing wind. And it said they began to speak in different languages. So God, even right now, God, we just lift up our voices. Come on, put something in the atmosphere. Put praise and worship in the atmosphere. Words of affirmation. Tell him how good he is, how faithful he is, how just he is. God, we thank you for life in our bodies this morning, for breath. Yes, Jesus, that we can lift our hands, that we can stand on our feet, Jesus. And even if there's some who can't, God, we speak healing in the atmosphere. Yes, Father, I feel that real strong healing in the atmosphere, healing online, Father God. And even as we step in front, God, for others, God, this morning, Father. And we want your Holy Spirit to come and move with us, Jesus. We're going to go for it. Come on, let's go for it, Tim. Come on. Come on, keep them hands stretched high. Put words of praise in the atmosphere. Oh yeah. Come on, if you know what, sing it.
Say, there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Said, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Yeah. Your presence, Lord.
We sing this out.
Yeah. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. And come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Come on, worship him. Come on. Your presence.
Your presence, Lord.
Come on, team. Let's sing this all together. Come on, sing it out, y'all. Come on.
There's nothing worse.
Sing.
There's nothing worth more.
Yeah.
That could ever come close. Nothing. Yeah.
Nothing can compare.
You're our living hope.
You're our living hope.
Yeah. Your presence, say.
Your presence, Lord.
Come on, here I sing it out. Come on.
I've tasted and seen. Yeah.
Say it.
I've tasted and seen.
Of the sweetest.
Of the sweetest of
when my heart becomes free.
When my heart becomes free.
And my shame is undone.
And my shame is undone.
God, we lie naked before you this morning. Your presence, Lord.
Your presence.
Yeah. Yeah. Come on, let's sing this part out. Come on. Said, Holy Spirit, say,
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Yeah, come flood this place.
Flood this place and we'll be at
yeah,
your glory.
Yeah.
God is what our hearts
to be overcome, yeah.
To be overcome by your presence. Lord,
Holy Spirit, say,
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Come
flood this place and fill the atmosphere.
Your glory,
your
God,
glory, God, is what our hearts
to be overcome,
to
say,
be overcome
by your presence,
by your presence.
Lord. on, set some hands and sing, yeah. Your
presence, Lord.
That's all we ask of you, Jesus, yes.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence,
Lord. Yeah. I love this part. Come on.
So let us become more aware of your presence.
Come on, sing. Let
us experience the glory of your goodness.
Let us become more aware of your presence.
Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Let us become, say,
let us become
more aware. Sing it real big, come on, sing. Say, Holy Spirit, say.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Come flood this place.
This place and fill the atmosphere.
Not just this room, but our hearts, Father. Come on, your glory.
Yeah.
To be overcome by your presence. Come on. Said Holy Spirit, say,
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Come here, God,
come flood this place and fill the atmosphere.
Your glory, God,
to
be overcome
by your presence.
Keep it real big, come on. Come on, now lift up his name. Lift up the name of Jesus. Come on. Lift up the name of Jesus. Lift up the name of Jesus. Yeah. 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 We lift up the name of Jesus. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Oh. Come on. Oh, 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 oh. Come on, declare. Come on. Oh, 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 oh. We say the name Jesus. Say the name Jesus. Say the name Jesus. Jesus. We say the name Jesus. We say the name Jesus. We say the name Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. Say. We say the name Jesus. Say the name Jesus. Say the name Jesus. Jesus, we say the name Jesus. Say the name Jesus.
Say the name Jesus.
Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. The name that saves, the name that heals. Yeah, Jesus. The name that saves, the name that heals. Jesus. The name that breaks every power of the enemy. Yes, Jesus. The name that breaks every power of the enemy. Yeah, yeah. Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. 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 Do you want to clear that? Come on.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Jesus. Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Y'all sing, ho.
Sing it again. Sing it again. Spirit, Lord,
your Spirit, Lord,
fill us.
Your Spirit, Lord,
yes.
Your Spirit, Lord,
your Spirit, Lord.
Go ahead and ask Him to fill you.
Your Spirit, Lord.
Fresh and anew, Holy Spirit. Have your way, have your way. Someone needs to just go ahead and yield and say, begin in me. Some of us, we've been fighting, or we've been struggling to do things on our own, but it's not by might. It's not by power. You and I, we can't do it. It's by the Spirit of the Lord that the mountain is made a plain. The mountain that stands before you, the mountain that's always been there, the mountain of the report of the doctor, it's not moving on its own. But where the Spirit of the Lord is, Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Whatever chains have to be broken to establish liberty, whoever has been master before, whatever has been dictating and controlling your life before, has to bow. Holy Spirit, have your way, have your way, have your way. Have your way. Fill. Lord God, as a rushing mighty wind, fill. Our Lord, let your river flow. The river whose streams make glad the city of God. May the river flow and everything that is sick, everything that is depressed, everything that is broken. We thank you, Lord, where the river flows. Lord God, that river that flows out of our belly, the living water. I thank you, Lord, where the river flows. Your healing love and mercy is established. Someone is here who needs healing. You need healing in your soul. You're broken. I want you to know that he's come to heal the brokenhearted. You're broken. Your health is broken. It seems like even your sanity might be broken. Your peace is broken. When the Holy Spirit comes, he fills those voids, those vacuums, those empty places. Allow him to fill. Allow him to go where it hurts. Allow God to touch you. Receive right now. The presence of God is here. We receive what God is offering by faith. We receive our healing. We receive our restoration. Even now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your Spirit establishes liberty in our lives. Your Holy Spirit establishes liberty in Jesus' name. You're not bound. You're not bound by what's happened to you. You're not a victim of your trauma. The Holy Spirit has come in to bring life and to bring freedom and to bring liberty because he loves you. And he doesn't want to see you tormented. He doesn't want to see you crying to sleep. He doesn't want to see you visited by enemies in darkness at night. Allow God to touch you. Allow God to heal you. Allow God to fill you afresh and anew. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, we receive the touch. We receive, Lord God, your healing mercy. We receive your grace. We receive the outpouring of your Spirit right now upon our flesh, upon that part that is bleeding and dying, Lord. We receive, Lord God, even now. Come on, there's an anointing that breaks the yoke. You got to believe in the power of God. You got to believe in the name of Jesus until you cry out. Like Barnabas, Jesus, son of David, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy on me. In the name of Jesus, we cry out. We're not ashamed. We're not embarrassed to cry out because we need you. Maybe your neighbor doesn't need him, but you got to say, Lord, I need you and I can't go without you. I need you, Lord God. I'm helpless and hopeless without you, Lord. I call on you. You said, call on me, and I will answer you. I need someone right now in desperation who needs a touch from God to call on Jesus and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Thank you, Jesus. He is moved towards you with compassion. Jesus looked and saw the leper. Lord, if you want to, you can touch me. I know protocol says you can't, but Lord, if you are willing, you can touch me and make me whole. And he looked and he was moved toward him with compassion. God's not mad at you. He has moved and he's looked upon you. And he sees all of the hurt. He sees your pain. And he's moved towards you right now with compassion. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for loving us. We don't take your love for granted. but we respond to your love with absolute worship. King of glory, you are welcome. Come in. This is your service. We are your people. Everything belongs to you. We lay our crowns before you. And we say, take full control of our hearts, of our lives. We open ourselves to receive you. And we invite you to have your way in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. He's having his way. He's having his way. He's having his way. He's moving what doesn't belong. He's speaking to your heart. He's making adjustments. God is getting everything in arrange in your life the way he likes it. He's arranging your life the way he likes it. The way that pleases him. And what we say is yes. Do it, Jesus. Even if it makes me uncomfortable, Lord, we want you to be comfortable. And I want you to be comfortable in my life. And so we invite you to do so. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Ah, there's so much anointing and power in this place. Stretch out your faith and believe God for something impossible today. In Jesus' name. Well, we're excited, so glad you're here worshiping with us. You may be seated. Welcome to those who are watching online. We encourage you to like, subscribe, share, spread the good news that Jesus is alive and Jesus is moving. We have some special things that we want to share with you, so pay close attention to what's going on the screen. God bless you.
Good morning, Lutheran Christian Center family and friends. My name is Brandon Watson, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to our service here today. If this is your first time joining us, I would like to say an extra special welcome to you. We believe that God has a blessing in store for you, so we encourage you to prepare your hearts to receive. In times like these, it's really important that we stay connected and informed. So here's the rundown of everything you need to know about what's happening here at WCC. Hi, are you new to our WCC family? Welcome to you. Please join us for anything you hear in today's announcements. If you are joining us in person, please visit our guest lounge directly after service. We would love to say hello. Parents in Aurora and Carol Stream, you are invited to attend the KB Kids Ice Cream Social today after service. Come and fellowship with the other KB families and learn all the new updates to our scripture memorization program. Our next service of baby dedication will take place on Sunday, September 18th. If you would like to participate in this service or know someone who would like to, visit our Church Center app or our website for more information. The next session of Connect Groups begins the week of October 3rd. We are going to dig deeper into this powerful Becoming series. If you have not yet joined a Connect Group, what are you waiting for? This is a super cool way to do life together outside of the church setting. Are you interested in becoming a Connect Group leader? Go to our website to find out more details today. Thanks so much for joining us for worship. If you missed any of today's announcements, be sure to visit our social media sites to stay up to date with all the happenings here at WCC. Enjoy the rest of the service.
All right. Praise the Lord. So happy and delighted to be in the house with you today. We're going to get ready to worship God in giving and receiving. Praise the Lord. We're going to worship God in giving and receiving. And the Bible says something. I know there's in the body right now, there's a lot of discussion about tithing and giving and stuff like that. There's a lot of discussion about that. The Bible says that God will not. There's something that God is not going to tolerate or God is going to insist upon. And the Bible says that God will not be without a cheerful, hilarious, happy giver. Ever wonder why that giver is so happy? I believe that person is happy because they have a revelation of God's goodness. And there's a trust, and there's a peace, and there's a joy. I believe that the person is cheerful because they are excited about the Word of God. They realize the Word of God has changed them, and they have a joy. I encourage you as a believer, if you lost your joy, get it back. You ought to be excited every day about what God is doing. You ought to have, and I ought to have, an expectancy. You see, you can't look at what's going on in the world. You can't look at the news and get excited. You can't look at the economy of man and get excited. You can't look at all the challenges. Maybe Goliath is in your life somewhere in a corner making noise. And get excited. But when you've tasted and seen God's goodness and you know that God is faithful and your trust is in the Lord, you are excited to advance God's kingdom. God is going to find somebody. And I believe God's going to find somebody right here in Wheaton Christian Center. God's going to find someone online that is excited, that has a revelation of God, and who loves God, and God so loved. You can't stop someone who's in love from giving. So I encourage you to obey God. And as you obey God, I want you to continue to rejoice and continue to be happy and hilarious. Praise his name. Well, before I get into the word, as some of you know, my wife, she is in Dallas right now. She is taking care of her mother. And, you know, the Bible says to honor your father and mother. And so she is, her mother's had some knee operations, and she really needs her. So Fiona has been gone. And someone just pray for me. Pray for me, because you know how I am without my wife. I'm struggling sometimes. I don't know how I used to do this before. And she asked me to announce, there's something, you know, sometimes when she's speaking, I'm not really paying attention. She asked me to announce something. And when I figured, I'm not going to announce it again, because if I don't announce it, it's going to teach her not to stay away from her husband so long. So we're just going to ignore what Fiona wants, something about the women, but we're going to go ahead and ignore that. And wait a second. Ms. Media Revolt. What?
Sorry, I got to jump in here myself and talk about something that's very important. Because last week, you know, I tried to get an announcement through, you know, a sister could not get an announcement through. So I said, you know what, I better just come in here and announce this thing myself. Ladies, October 22nd, we're going to be having a one-day prayer boot camp. One day, October 22nd from 9 to 4. So I want you to mark the date, save the date. Registration is starting soon. This is going to be a power-packed day. We're going to be taught on how to pray, even specifically for the different seasons of life that we're in. You know what? I am super excited about the session with Pastor Sheila. She is going to be ministering and talking to the young women, especially those who are entering the season of marriage. She's going to be giving you practical tools on how to prepare yourself for marriage and even how to pray for marriage. So don't miss it. But the entire day is going to be power-packed, and we're going to leave the session empowered, equipped with all the information and knowing how to pray for the different things that we need in our lives. So mark the day, October 22nd, and folks, it's going to be from 9 to 4. Watch out for the registration. Make sure that we have your email address so you can get the information. And you know what, before I jump off, I want to say thank you so much for praying for me, for praying for my mom. She is doing really well. She's recovering well. The doctors are amazed. So thank you. Continue to pray for her and continue to pray for my strength. God is good, and most importantly, pray for your pastor's strength. All right, pray for your strength. But I hope to see you soon. I love you guys. I miss you. God bless you. Pastor Paul, you can have your service back. Bye.
You know, if she wasn't so fine, I would be angry. But it was just good to see her. I was the first time seeing that like you. I got to talk to the media department. That's mutiny. That's mutiny. When I'm in the service, I'm in control here. I'm on stage, and she wives submit. All right. Isn't it how husbands say that verse? It's not their verse, but husbands love that verse, although that verse is not their verse. All right, you guys ready to jump into the Word? All right, let's jump into the Word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Word, which lives and abides forever. May your Word live in us. Cause us to come to new life today. Hearts are open, our minds are alert, we're ready to receive what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us, the church, and we commit to be doers of the Word of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Join me in Luke chapter 6. We're on a value series. Now, if you go outside, you'll see that we have some values, and the values that we have direct our decisions and what we do, and so we have some values in this church, and we want these values to become personal to you as well. And so we're on these value series, and so we're talking about some things here, and today I'm dealing with integrity, and we're calling it becoming fortified. Becoming fortified. In Luke chapter 6, verse 46, it says, "But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my saying and does them, I will show you whom he's like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. But he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built a house on earth without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great." Becoming fortified. I like to think of myself as being built to last. Whatever it is that you've gone through, and some of us have gone through some very traumatic things in life. Some of us have seen some things which are difficult, painful. Some of us have gone through very dark and lonely valleys. I want you to know that you are fearfully and wonderfully made, and God has built you to weather those storms that you have gone through. You're built to last. You're built to persevere. You're capable of walking through that difficult situation victorious. Jesus gives a parable about the one who hears and obeys the word. Now, I'm speaking right now in the midst of a storm. I mean, if you look at me and you say, what's kind of off with him? He kind of looks like he lost his best friend. He did. And I can feel in my body the grief that is coming in. And when that grief is coming in, I have to go and do what I know to do. I have to go to the foundation because the storm is designed to take me out. You know, people die of grief. When things happen, it's not just the initial trauma, but it's the after effect that takes us out. It wasn't just the Hurricane Katrina that brought the devastation. It was after the storm had passed and the effects of that storm that brought so much loss and death and pain. Some of us, the aftermath is what is killing us. And you're built to handle it. You're built to endure it. You're built to last. But in order to do so, you and I, we have to be fortified. We have to be fortified. There were people celebrating in May 2001. There was a wedding in Jerusalem at the Versailles Banquet Hall, beautiful hall, made to look like Italy and so forth. And it was a glorious celebration. I mean, 650 people or so came out to this wedding. And after the wedding ceremony, they went to the reception hall, the Versailles reception hall, and it was magnificent. And they had the party on the third floor where they were celebrating and dancing of this wonderful occasion, celebrating people falling in love and getting married. And while they were celebrating and dancing, in Jewish celebrations, they would also put the bride and the groom on a chair and carry them while the music is going and everything. And the floor collapsed. Over 300 people were injured, 23 people dead. There was a structural issue. Says, he who hears my word and does them. He's like a man who was building a house, dug deep on a rock. Integrity is one of our values. In the church, we say this is something that we want to base what we do and how we operate and function as a church. And this church, this ministry over the years has been known as a ministry of integrity. We preach the word of God without compromise. We're committed to love God's people. We're committed to walk in holiness, especially as leaders. And we praise God that there haven't been scandals associated with the leaders of this church. There's been a stability that's been a part of this ministry for years. We have in this church people who are third generation. That means their parents were here, brought their children, and their children have gotten married and have children that are here. Safe and stable place. Integrity. But when I began to dig deeper and to look personally, search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me. Know every anxious thought. I began to put the microscope on my own heart and on my own life. There's integrity before people. And that's based on man's standard. That means you don't see any outbroken sin. You don't see the preacher involved in adultery and stuff like that. But when we start to dig deeper, you start to realize, when you call yourself a man or a woman of integrity based on God's standard, you're calling that yourself that by faith. Because God's standard is perfect holiness. God's standard, integrity means it's the quality of being honest, having strong moral principles, moral uprightness. It's the state of being whole and undivided. It's the condition of being unified, unimpaired, or sound in construction. God's word can be trusted. God's word is faithful. God's word is true. Psalm 119, verse 160 says, Your word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endure forever. It's not going to break down. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If you ever trusted God's word, you can trust it today. It doesn't change. It's never outdated. It's never out of style. God's word is true from the beginning, and his judgments are not only for a specific time and then they expire, but his righteous judgments endure forever. You might say these are changing times in the Bible. That book is antiquated. You can't apply it today. Yes, you can. God's word, you can stand on it. It's speaking today. In many times, in many ways, God has spoken. Hebrews 1 says, in times past, in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son. God's standard is holiness. God, in 2 Samuel 22, verse 31, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is proven. God's standard is best. That means he is the standard. He is the first and second, an infinite opinion. It doesn't get any better. It cannot be improved upon. It says God's standard is superior as the heavens. Isaiah 55, verse 9. Are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. God's standard doesn't change. I am the Lord, Malachi 3:6, and do not change. Jesus is God's standard. Jesus is God's perfect standard. I looked at my life and I saw some holes in my integrity. I realized that in and of myself, that building is destined to collapse. When the storm came, when the floods rose, the fall of that house was great. There was great destruction, great pain, and great loss. And if you are choosing to be honest, you are aware there's some gaps in the construction. There are some things in your life that are lacking that need to be there. And if they don't arrive in your life is heading for a crash. Jesus represents God's standard because Jesus did it right perfectly. And Ephesians 2, verse 20 says, we have been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Jesus is the foundation, is the standard that we stand on. So when Peter says, you are the Christ, Jesus' response is, upon this rock, I will build my church. My church will be well built because it's built on the revelation of who I am, Jesus says. Upon this rock, I will build my church. We haven't been built on the apostles, the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Jesus, when he was speaking to the religious leaders, he says, you talk about all these prophets, they all prophesied concerning me. They rejoiced to see my day. We're built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone that holds everything together. Jesus met the standard, and Jesus is God's standard. But back to us. Romans 3, verse 10, it says, there is no one that is righteous. So being fortified, it implies righteousness in the kingdom. It implies integrity in the kingdom. But the problem is, there is no one righteous, no, not one. And that's the issue that we're dealing with. Because our integrity has been compromised. This is something that we're not very aware of. It doesn't stay on the forefront of our mind, but your integrity has been compromised. You are compromised. I'm compromised. Follow me as I follow Christ. But there's no human being that follows Christ perfectly. That's why Paul says, as I follow Christ, because if you see me deviate from Christ, stop following me. If I say something that is not in line with the word of God, search the scriptures for yourself. Don't just have the word you receive at church be the only word you get. Learn how to dig. Learn how to feed yourself. We start off feeding babies, but if the baby is 35 years old with a beard, and you're still saying, open up, open up, here comes the train, choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo. If you still got to do all that, something's wrong. You have to know how to go to the word for yourself. When I am dealing with the storm of my life, I have to go to the word. I have to go to God, who is my refuge and my strength, a present help. I have to learn to go to the word and cast these burdens, these cares, this grief upon the Lord, because he cares for me. I have to go to the word when I'm going through a storm and seeing what happened to my friend. He's a man of God. We prayed. We believed God. And I watched cancer eat him slowly, and he still has a lot of life to live, children to raise in the fear and admonition of the Lord. We're standing in faith. I refuse to speak anything negative. We continue to believe God for a miracle. We sing together, I shall not die, but live and declare. Still, get the call. Devin's gone. I've watched people, when storms hit, I've watched people lose their faith in God. I've watched people throw their hands up and say, I don't want this. We know he's God, we know he can. Why didn't he do it? Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. You see, it's one thing to lift our hands to dance in church. It's another thing to still worship God in the eye of the storm. What happens when things are going on and things are happening and you have to deal with things and you don't understand why? I had to go to the Word. I had to go to 1 Corinthians and realize that I'm looking through a dark glass, trying to make sense. Paul says we know in part and we prophesy in part. So there's no preacher, I don't care how schooled, how anointed, there's no praying mother in Zion that has so much Holy Ghost that they know more than part. Because Paul, who had been to the third heaven and saw things that he couldn't even articulate, says that I know in part, prophesy in part. Why so downcast, oh my soul? Feel the pain in my stomach, just won't go away. You ever have a gut punch? Takes the wind out of you. There, it's gnawing. Doesn't go away. Why so downcast? God's not afraid of your questions. He's not afraid of your questions. He's not intimidated by your questions. Looking through a glass darkly, trying to make sense. My God, why? But I realize even in that, which I don't understand, which is cloudy, which is stormy, I keep looking through that dark glass, knowing in part, with the hope and the expectation I will see God. I don't understand it. It's cloudy, it's murky, but God, I know you're there. I know your love is there. I know you love my best friend more than I ever could in 1,000 lifetimes. Lord, I know you're there. Lord, I know you're good. Lord, I know you're faithful. Lord, I know you are Jehovah Rapha. I know how God anointed Jesus Christ, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, because God was with him. So, I have to go in my weakness to the place of strength. Because we live in a surrounding, in a setting where everything is crashing around us. I wish I could prophesy to you that things were going to get better in this life. I wish I can just use the campaigns and say we're gonna make it great. I wish I can say we're gonna build back better. Wish I could say that. I see in this word that there's going to be a great falling away. I see that sin is going to abound, but grace is going to much more abound. I see what is going on in the world where Jesus says in Matthew 24 that there's going to be famine and there's going to be pestilence. So when they think they got one disease or one virus controlled, the Bible says another one's coming. When we see what's going on in the world, it just reminds us that this world is crashing. We've compromised. Sin, missing the mark, missing God's standard, comes at great cost. Sin is the one thing we all have in common, but no one wants to talk about. Sin. King Saul, he was king before King David. Compromise cost him the kingdom. 1 Samuel 13:13. The prophet comes to Saul and tells him, you've done foolishly. And because you compromised, you disobeyed, the kingdom is going to be taken from you and given to a man after God's own heart. We see even in a nation, Proverbs 14:34, righteousness exalts a nation. Sin is a reproach to any people. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. Compromise is killing us. Not meeting God's standard is destroying us. Playing around with the things of God comes at a great price. Not dealing with our own lives and repenting and saying, God, I'm sorry, create in me a clean heart, renew a right spirit within me, comes with a cost. Doing things our way. Not obeying and honoring the truth. When the truth is unpopular. And just going and blending with popular thought is going to come at a cost. We've compromised. God's ways are higher, his thoughts are higher. But now we're throwing out God's ways. And we're coming up with something better than God's ways. God says this is the standard. This will cause you to be established. This, if you build your life on the rock, throughout the various seasons of life, you will be able to stand strong and tall. If you build your life, if you build your marriage, if you build your family, if you build your career on my word, you'll be able to last. Doesn't matter what's going on around you, but you're anchored. Jesus is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. But remember, we have to check the context because there's some things we could be desensitized to. And without knowing, it's possible to throw out God's way because we've gotten smarter, more sophisticated, and after all, it's 2022. Righteousness is going to exalt. Sin is going to be the bring the building of your life crashing down. Righteousness exalts. Sin brings shame. Some things in my life I'm ashamed of. Some things in my life are embarrassing. Some things in your life that nobody sees, God sees. And there's going to be a day when the secrets that are in our heart will be revealed. It's better to repent today. It's better to ask God to cleanse you and wash you and purge you today. It's better to seek God today and call on him while he may be found. It's better to awake from spiritual slumber today. They're partying, they're drinking, this is good. I mean, it's Miller time, celebrating, not realizing that they're standing on a condemned foundation. The world is passing and the desires in this world are passing. And we're dancing. Just unaware what time it is. We want to change God's order. We want to break up the foundation, but Psalm 11:3 says, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations, if we're going to be fortified, you have to have foundations in your life. You have to be anchored in Christ. You have to be, your life has to be built on the word of God. We have to pay attention to what God is saying. We have to surrender our lives to Christ and receive the forgiveness of sins. And die to our own wills and desires and say, for me to live is Christ. If you don't have this, if you haven't gone through this, your foundation is messed up. Right now, in the culture, everything is geared and designed and fixed for the individual. And so it's all about you. Everyone is doing what is right to them. And we have our own truth that we choose to live by. When Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No, I got my own truth. I got to do what's right for me. The individual is elevated. So it's no longer about what God says, it's all about what we say. Very dangerous compromise. God says, my ways are not your ways. Interesting, when they decided to follow Jesus, they said that they were following the way. Before they were called Christians, they were the ones that were followers of the way. We found a different way. And we are pulling up the foundations. And that's why we're seeing mass destruction. I said before that when society's rose to prominence, there was a foundation of family. Even if they weren't saved or didn't believe in Jesus or didn't believe in God, if they exercised the biblical principles and did things the way God set them up, those societies and cultures would prosper. But now more than ever, marriage is under attack. There's a lady by the name of Julie Bindle. She writes for The Guardian. And what she says is, marriage is an outmoded institution built on patriarchal inequality that has no place in modern society. That's the thinking of this culture. They have devalued marriage. And the fact that they've devalued marriage, it doesn't mean that they stop having sex. And so when we uproot the foundation, then you have in some communities 75-80% of children born out of wedlock. What helps stabilize my children, and the same thing that helped stabilize me, is that I saw stability with mom and dad. And that gave me a peace and a security. Now we change the foundation and we say, free love, you can do whatever you want to do. And the wages of sin brings death. In Numbers chapter 25, the children of Israel were a blessed people. They were the descendants of Abraham. They're moving toward the promised land. God is before them as a pillar of cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night. And they found themselves going through Moab. And the king of Moab tried to hire, Balak tried to hire Balaam to go and curse them. Balaam seems a donkey and doesn't curse them but blesses them. But Revelation talks about the sin of Balaam. And Balaam says, these people are blessed, and you can't curse what God has blessed. Amen. This is the principle. When God has blessed you, you don't have to come to me about a witch or a warlock that, you know, who is doing juju on you and has spoken a curse. Amen. Because devils know and demonic powers know they cannot curse. Amen. What God has blessed. Greater is he that's in you, and they know that. Spiritual forces know that. You can't curse what God has blessed. But Balaam says, I'll tell you what to do. Get them into sin, and they will curse themselves. Get them into sexual sin. If they commit sexual sin, the building is crashing. He who sins sexually sins against his or her own body. And they will be destroyed. So they said they got those fine Moabite women to walk around the children of Israel and taught them some new things sexually. And the Israelite men went like a lamb to the slaughter, like a fool before the correction stocks. And when they got into sin, the judgment of God came. 23,000-24,000 of them died in the plague. Wages of sin brings death. we deviate from God's law, God's way, it brings death. When they wanted to establish, the Soviet Union, they had the Bloody October in 1917. It was Red October, and they have the Bolshevik Revolution at that time. That's when Lenin, came and emerged as a leader, and they were bringing in the communist government during that time. What they had to do in order for them to bring that in, first thing they had to do is they had to get rid of the church. During that time, 200 million left the Orthodox Church in Russia. Because before that time, in order to get married, marriage was sacred. And because marriage was sacred, people had to get married in the church. And the church had to sanction their marriage. And in the same way, they couldn't just get divorced, because the church would have to sanction their divorce, and they weren't about to do that. But when they wanted to come in and destabilize, they created the separation, got rid of the church, and what they did was they were giving freedom to do what you want, to live how you want to live. You want a divorce? No problem. You want an abortion? We got you. Continue. And as they continued to do so, it became all about the individual. Oh, you thought I was doing the black power sign, right? No, this is Marxism. Let's get God out the picture and let people live for themselves. If we can get you to live for yourself, if we can get you to do what you want to do, we will bring down marriage. We can open things up. And that's when you can open things up to all kinds of perversion, because the structure and the system that God put in place to keep children safe, we've destroyed that system. We disrespect parents. Remember, the Bible speaks about the last days when there's a form of godliness. One of the things that is going to be prevalent is disrespect. So if we can plant seeds of disrespect, if we can make it so that the parents in the family don't have as much power over the children, let's diminish the influence of the parents. Because whenever you have strong families, you don't need big government when there's strong families. You need bigger government when there's, everybody's individual and you. But when the family is together and strong, we can deal with, my parents didn't need the police. They would serve justice themselves. They served me with justice so many times. Sometimes I wanted mercy, and I got justice. When your family is strong, no. As a child, I would have wanted the police. I want the police to come save me. When the family is intact, you didn't need all that government. But now we've diminished the influence of the parents. We've diminished the influence of the grandparents. We're a culture of disrespect. And if the foundations are destroyed, then kids, they're going to grow up and there's no law to govern, because they've been trained to do what they want. They've been trained to choose their own pronoun. They've been trained, it's about them. They've been trained that they live unto themselves. I was trained, we don't live to ourselves. No man lives to himself. God says, my ways are higher. You live for me. For me to live is Christ. We don't live for ourselves. We don't live to do what we want. Our God cannot be our own belly. And this is what we have to correct, because it's embedded. And it's hard to build people up in the Lord when they are the law and the ruler of their own lives. They are their own authority. Does it matter what the Bible says? No, no, no. I don't read the Bible that way. I'm not going to take that literally. When there's sin, it's going to bring death. And that's how we see the enemy wanting to tear God's people down. Get you to focus on yourself. Get you to focus on what's best for you. Get you to live for you. Get you to do what you want. Remove you and isolate you. Isolate you, separate you from the brethren. Separate you from other believers. Get people away. Make, you know, why? The church in general, people attending church, coming together in the nation that's in decline. It's all designed for the crash. And so I encourage you, I admonish you in the Lord to be strong, to be vigilant. Amen. Amen. Your adversary, you have an enemy that walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I encourage you. You and I, we need accountability. We need someone to check us. We need someone that is going to watch over our souls as those that must give account. We have to stay together. We don't live for the individual. I can't live to do what I want and do what I feel. No, no, no. I need people in my life who are going to speak the truth in love. You need people in your life who are going to speak the truth in love. If the foundations are destroyed, the culture, the system that we're in, the system of darkness is designed to destroy you. It's designed to destroy the foundation. If the enemy can remove the foundation, the building is condemned already. But we serve a God that's able to restore. We serve a God that's able to go to the broken places and bring restoration. Where there's been lack of trust, where there's been lack of hope, God is able to restore and save that which has been lost in your life, that which has been a void in your life. I encourage you, those who feel that they're hopelessly bankrupt, to look to God. He's a God of restoration. He's a God that's able to restore the foundation. Yes, yes, we're going through a difficult time. We're going through a storm. We're going through issues and challenges right now, but I encourage you to gird yourself up in God. Stand on Christ, the solid rock. Begin to stand on the word. You are not your feelings. You are not your emotions. You are not what's happened to you. You are who God says you are. Go to the rock. Go to the rock. Go to the rock. Take your issues. Take your person, your entire being to the rock, and you will find security and shelter and safety and stability. It's not just about you. It's not just about you. It's important that we realize that God has yoked us together, and we all are in the body, and we might have different parts of the body, but it's so important that we stay connected as the body. There were some things that weren't connected. We are living stones built upon the apostles' teaching. Jesus Christ being the cornerstone. And so, like me, you have holes, you have gaps, you have inconsistencies. But we refuse to go it alone and do it ourselves. It takes humility to say, God, I need you to restore me. I need you to restore the broken places. Because there's something in me that wants to go off on its own and think my own thoughts and do my own thing. But no one is a law to themselves. It's foundations. The foundations of faith that have kept me, that will keep you. Stand to your feet. Praise you, Jesus. God is faithful. God is faithful. God is building you to withstand what's going on in the culture. There are some things in the culture. There are some things, I don't know what's in the water, but there's something in the water that's designed to eat away at your faith. It's designed to keep you from putting your trust in God and trusting God's goodness and God's faithfulness. And it's going to make you say, I'll do it myself. Jesus is coming right now to restore. He hasn't come to condemn you. He hasn't come to condemn your life, to condemn the building. I haven't come to condemn. I've come to save you. I've come to restore you. I've come to heal you. Come to deal with your brokenness. Becoming fortified. As a disciple of Christ, God is equipping you to stand, and having done all, to stand in spite of what the culture is telling you to do. You're going to stand for Christ in a dark, crooked, perverse generation. If you're the generation that's going to see Jesus come, he's going to come finding faith in you. Because you will believe God. No matter how hard it is, no matter if you're looking through a glass darkly, Lord, it's dark, but I'm gonna stand on what I know, and I know that you're a good God. I know that you love me, and I know that you're calling me to walk in holiness. I know you're calling me to walk in forgiveness. You're calling me to walk in purity. You're calling me to love. And I refuse to bow to the culture. I refuse to give in to what's popular. Foundations are not pretty. Foundations are not popular. It's not pleasant. It's hard. It's heavy. But you're built for these times. Heavenly Father, you are our sure foundation. You are our rock, our fortress, our deliverer. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Your life is falling apart. Your emotions are taking you every which way. I encourage you. Got a word from the Lord for you today. God is going to stabilize you. God is going to stabilize you. God is going to be your foundation in this season. Because there are some things that are trying to pull you away from faith. Pull you away from God's purpose. God's will. If you want prayer, you want the assurance. Oh, he loves you. He loves you. He loves you. And it's his love that convicts you, that says you got to change. He loves you enough to say the building is coming down and you can't fix it. You can't fix it. You can't change it on your own. But I've come to help you to avoid the disaster. This plane is crashing. But I'm your parachute. You need Jesus in these troubling times, these changing times. You need Jesus. You need God's salvation. You need to experience new life in Christ. You need to be baptized in water. You need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The anointing and power of God is here to transform your life. The anointing and grace of God can deal with your character issues. It's a journey, it's a process. I know I said I got some holes in my life, but there are a lot of holes that I've seen filled. And by faith, not based on my performance, not based on my righteousness. My integrity is never based on me. My integrity is based on the fact that Jesus did it right, and he's my representation. He's the one that stands in my behalf. When I got it wrong and I messed up, I confess my sin. I confess, Lord, I'm in need of prayer. Some people don't want to confess. You got to admit that you're a mess. The Word of God is a mirror, and it's going to tell you how you really are. We can forget and we can start to think that we're all that because you got some money in the bank or whatever. No. Revelation says you are broke and you are naked. You are busted and disgusted. You are a mess that's going someplace to create more mess and more heartache. But Jesus has come to make all things new. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. If you want Christ, if you want the grace of God, the grace of God that brings stability in your life and all this confusion and all this perversion, you don't want that perversion to get into you. Jesus has come to save you. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I admit that I have sinned and fallen short of your glory. I'm calling on you now. Save me. Deliver me. Heal me. Set me free. Renew my mind. Change my thinking to think your thoughts. I repent. I acknowledge my sin, and I receive your forgiveness and your freedom. In Jesus' name, I renounce the devil, every demonic force that has attacked my life. I plead the blood of Jesus to sanctify me and set me apart to fulfill God's purpose in my life. In the name of Jesus, I'm a force to be reckoned with in the kingdom of God. I'm living by the word of God. I'm hearing what God is saying, and I'm obeying the voice of my God. In Jesus' name, give God praise right now. Hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, right now we just thank you and bless you for the time we've had together in your presence. We thank you for fullness of joy. We thank you that we're going forth strong in the power of your might. And no weapon, no force of darkness can stop us because we are on kingdom assignment. We receive the sufficiency of your grace. We receive your strength made perfect in our weakness. For when we are weak, we are strong. For the power of God rests upon us. In Jesus' name, we go forth in joy. We're led forth in peace, and the mountains and hills break before us into singing, and all the trees of the field do clap their hands. All sorts and conditions of people will praise God because we've stepped in with the anointing and power of God to speak a word in season. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you so that Jesus is seen all over you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name. Wheaton Christian Center, Isn't Jesus wonderful? If you need prayer, come forward. If you need deliverance.